Good afternoon, evening, Fleet Activities Yokosuka, Nagishi, Ikego, main base, parts unknown, people on YouTube, wherever this comes out, downloading on AFN or something. I don't know where to go with this thing. But welcome to Commander's Corner. I am Captain Dave Glenister. With me, as always, is Master Chief Marty King. And we're here to give you some news you can use, read your ICE comments, the official way to have your comments asked and answered, and to put that word out. So we don't always go with every ICE comment that is out there, so just so you know. As I said this many times. So if you have a comment about a particular service, a particular person, you didn't get the right taco sauce on those things. But I'll talk about that actually today too, some of the supply logistics challenges that we are having because of supplies coming here at the NEX and the commissary. But this is the way you'll get your questions answered. So if sometimes you throw this grenade over the fence about some particular individual that gave you a bad customer service experience, we are going to address it. But a lot of times those are one-off type of things. So I just kind of deal with that and move on. But if there's ones that are more generic in nature or of value, or even for say, hey, we want to tell you how, here's how you would actually go about telling us there's a problem, we may talk about those. So if your comment doesn't get answered on the air, you will get a comment response to you directly unless you don't leave your contact information.
Yes.
I don't even know. Where can I go with that?
If you would like a response, give us your contact info.
Right.
That's the only way you're going to get the direct feedback. And we do give feedback on all ICE comments.
We do. And usually from the department head themselves,
yes.
Right, the actual person. So MWR is usually from, if it is sports, is the head of sports. If it's outdoor rec, it's the head of outdoor rec, et cetera, et cetera. Okay, so a couple things. Coming up on the 8th of March is the St. Patrick's Day Parade on base. Big event. A lot of our associated organizations, both on-base, off-base. Girl Scouts have the Japanese Girl Scouts. We're going to try and get some Japanese Boy Scouts. We have, the Kinnick Band. March is still working on the ROTC, trying to get them in there because they were a big hit last year. All kinds of tenant commands going there. We're going to have, set up there by the bowling alley type area, our Irish dancing and music and food. It's going to be just a fun day event. So 8th of March, that is a Sunday.
Yes, it is.
It's a Sunday, and it should be a fun time, so mark your calendar on that.
Last year's was the first one, and it was extremely successful. We had a couple thousand people there.
It was. It was actually bigger than 4th of July.
Yes.
Bigger than 4th of July. It was, of course, one of the best days after a lot of snow.
Yes.
So that didn't hurt our attendance, I will tell you that. But it is a fun event, so come on out for that. And if you got to dress warmly, dress warmly. Okay. We do have more ships coming here this year. I think a lot of folks know that, but... we do have, this summer, we have one cruiser and one destroyer who are going to be permanently assigned here, or at least for everyone else's PRD that's here, there will be more ships. And what does that mean? It means we have more ships and more sailors. You can take that for what it's worth. But we're working with the city and some of the other parts of support, like the ship repair facilities, hiring more people and some of the things, but... No, that's what it is. So we're looking at probably maybe another 150 families or so, plus another 600 sailors, 700 sailors-ish, just in this part. That's in addition to the a lot of you know, the George Washington and the Ronald Reagan are swapping hulls. But in addition to that, two more ships coming. So just so you're aware, if you see another ship, you got some more shipmates out there to take care of. So those of you who are in this responsive business, the USO, the Red Cross, and other stuff, I think a lot of us know because we talk about it at our weekly...
Yes.
Base support meeting. But yeah, there you have it. Supply, logistics, this West Coast slowdown. As many of you are aware or should reasonably be becoming aware, we are starting to get impacted, the NEX, the commissary, other places, with the supply chain of things that come from the West Coast of the United States. The Secretary of Labor is out there trying to as we would say in the Pentagon, trying to push a rope. You can't push a rope, right? But he's trying to push a rope and trying to move this thing along. He can only have – someone else has got to pull it. He's trying to get other people to pull and trying to get this thing resolved. But basically is the folks that work the docks, longshoremen, the shipping part of things that are just, I don't say, slow rolling. They're working at less capacity.
Yes.
And it's impacting a lot of folks. It's not a strike. It is a slowdown. There's a big difference. Not to us. The fact is that things are coming slower and slower. you will begin to see things that are not on the shelves. It may be transparent to you, but the school lunch program, sometimes they are substituting meals. No one's going to go hungry, but you know they're moving the menu items around with what they have. So you may have planned it out a long time, and where it said you were going to have pizza, you may have hot dogs, or I don't know what it is. But there are issues like that. I'm sure I will hear about it, you know, yes, when the kids don't get the pizza that they were expecting. But, you know, everything's going to be fine. And, oh, by the way, you got 400,000 people right outside the gate that are living and eating and doing all their things. So this is your big chance to kind of move out and take a look at the economy out there, especially your fresh produce. That's where you want to go anyway.
Get the options. Mm-hmm. Talk about that at AOVICR?
I do. Yeah. I do. Yeah, and, yeah, but you will start to see. I mean, we have been pretty, you know, you've had these little signs somewhere that say, hey, due to the West Coast slowdown or whatever, there's no Heineken or something like that. Well, we're getting to the point where we're just going to put one big sign in the front of the store because we'd have so many little signs around it look ridiculous. So you are going to see that. You are going to see that. So anyway, just be aware that's out there and, you know, it's okay. We'll be fine. We'll be fine. The last one, you know, looking through all these comments, the one comment I have not gotten in the ICE comments is about the thrift shop. Right?
Yeah.
There's a lot of Facebook. And there's a lot of mythology out there, but
unofficial Facebook.
Yeah, well, yes, not an official Facebook. But no one has actually asked me until actually the other day. I was at this Cub Scout leader meeting, and of course we have people from all over the base. This thing, and someone was asking about the thrift shop, Secondhand Rose, is the old thrift shop, and the fact that it's closing. And so here's really the story: is that you know, when we dissolved YOSC, the thrift shop said can stay open as long as you want until we get a new thrift shop. And so the folks that were running that, you know, we're looking at starting a new organization that would just be a thrift shop. And they were, you know, now bear in mind, this is a big operation. I mean, from a business. You're asking volunteers to create a business and spend their time doing it. And, you know, within the construct that that we gave them, they had some difficulty in trying to getting to yes or getting to that kind of element. And no harm on them. They are people trying to do the right thing, trying to get this thing going. And it's hard. So they have chosen to not continue that, which is okay. So I went to the Brigadier General retired Collins, who's a Marine Corps general. He's the chief. I think he's the chief operating officer of Navy Marine Corps Relief Society. You know, kind of a big corporate thing. And asked him if he would run a thrift shop for us. Because Navy Marine Corps Relief runs thrift shops all over the world. And he said he's going to take that back to their admiral. And you know, they're here to serve the fleet, so they would certainly do that, is his belief. So that's where we are right now. So all those things, all those items, all those things that you donate, because we don't have a thrift shop culture here in Japan. And so it's just as important to have a place to bring your stuff as it is a place to get other stuff. So that's where we stand. So I have every confidence that Navy Marine Corps Relief is going to open a thrift shop. And they will get all the inventory because that is how the dissolution clause was written for YOSC. Everything goes Navy Marine Corps Relief. This way, they don't even have to sell it; they can just give it as stuff, and we'll be good. So, but I thought I'd tell you because somebody asked me, and when they did, they said, "Oh, thank goodness!" Because people are pressurizing Oakleaf to try and start a thrift shop. I said, "Why are you doing that?" You know, all you got to do is ask, and you ask through ICE comments. So I thought I'd put that out there as an example of, hey, you have a lot of stuff out there. Put in an ICE comment, and you will get an answer. And the answer may not be satisfying, but the answer will be the official answer.
Yes, it will.
And that's good to have.
And it's a heck of a lot better answer than a lot of the, you know, there's a lot of different Facebook sites out there, social media sites. But you're talking about people that don't know a process, answering questions to a process, and you're not getting the right information. So, you know, if you're choosing to rely on that social media that is not coming directly from the provider, you're going to get a wrong answer. So the right way to do is feel free to use ICE or ask us directly when you see us around the installation.
That's right. You know, well, here's the thing about social media. Sometimes and oftentimes you might get the right answer. You might get the right answer 75% of the time, even 90% of the time. But remember, you're just asking your neighbor. Hey, does anyone know how to register a car? Okay, and the neighbor might know. Or they might say, sure, but they registered a car 3 years ago and the process has changed. So just go to our websites, go to our stuff and get the answer. So, okay. Speaking of bicycles and everything else, I'm not sure we were speaking of bicycles. Let's head into it now, okay? Riding in concern with bicycle impounded. More physical security evasion. Boy, this is poorly written. But I parked my bike near building E22. That's the old hospital building, still controlled by the hospital, but it is the old hospital. I parked my bike there for 3 years with no sign stating no parking. And I parked yesterday with no problem. Well, you can imagine where this is going. Bike's impounded. Okay. And he didn't get a warning. I should feel safe belonging. Okay, I can't even read the rest of this thing. But let me move on here. So the person is parked their bike there illegally for years. Now it got impounded, and they're upset by it. So periodically, physical security gathers up unsecured and unregistered bicycles due to the overwhelming amount of abandoned bicycles on board CFA. And I wish I could really just hand them off to orphans or something. But there's liability with that, because if the United States government, which is us, gives a substandard bike, one that doesn't meet standards, i.e. a kid gets hurt on this bike, we have liability. So I would love to just do that. But there's reasons why we have to hold them for a period of time. But we gather them up. And E22 is one of the places that bicycles are left to rot. It's like this, you know, the killing fields out there for bicycles or something. So in your particular case, the building manager called to complain about the bicycles. And according to our instruction, all bicycles that are not registered with CFA are going to get picked up. Right? They got to be registered, and they're going to be parked in authorized areas, and they're confiscated if they're parked illegally. They're parked illegally with a lock. Or, let's see, parked legally with – okay. Follow the rules. That's the bottom line. And the irony of this one, and why I'm kind of spending a lot of time on this, is every other time we could do this, there's like five comments against bike riders not following the rules. Yeah. I'm surprised that it's taken this long. I'm surprised a bike rider is complaining about the enforcement of the rules. But, yeah. So there's no pre-warning. There's no advanced stuff. If your bike's not registered, it's gone. Okay. If you illegally park it, we're going to take it. And so that's that. So, and the fact that you've been doing this for 3 years, you know, if you got pulled over by a cop or California Highway Patrol and said, "But officer, I speed every day and no one ever catches me," you think that's going to play well? It is not. Okay? So it doesn't matter if you haven't been caught doing something illegal for several years. Yes, register your bike. And I know there's other complaints in here. A lot of folks are zipping across traffic. If I had a non-lethal blow dart that would just remind people to follow the rules, I would use it, you know, because it irritates – not only irritates me,
it's dangerous.
The number one ER cause of trips to the ER is the bicycles. And they're not getting them off them in the crosswalks. Someone clips them. Or they're riding, you know, against traffic instead of with traffic every day. Every day. People in uniform, out of uniform. So anyway –
Bikes are non-motorized vehicles, and that's the way we look at it. It's a non-motorized vehicle. Man. It's subject to the traffic safety laws. And the other side of that is register your bike. And this is unfortunate, but we do have people who decide to take bicycles that are not theirs.
That is a shame.
What they do is they take that bike and then they abandon it somewhere.
Yeah.
But if you registered it and we have the sticker, we know how to get your bicycle back to you.
Here's another segue. I'm gonna jump on this thing. We have a massive lost and found at security. I don't think folks know that. Maybe we have a marketing problem on that thing. We have laptops. We've got phones. We've got all this stuff that no one comes a calling. And I said, well, if no one comes a calling, it's not because they've got $500 to burn on an electronic device. It's probably because they don't know it's there. So we do. Security has a lost and found. So when you leave your laptop or phone somewhere at food court, at the falls out of your pocket at a base theater or something, we have this lost and found. So if you have lost something, even if it's a long time ago, you still want to get it back probably. Security has that. So inquire into that. Lost and found, very important. You can get your stuff back. We keep it. You know, this is a good country. I think I told you last time. My phone lost it in Shizuoka, and unfortunately I think I also ran over it as I was pulling out. But anyway, somebody found it. Got a hold of the police, who got a hold of the company, who sent it back to me. I mean, I paid for shipping, but they sent it back. It's a great country, very honest people. So odds are we may have it. Okay. I realize that the Mini Mart in Ikego is a NEX-operated store, but the prices that we asked to pay store are outrageous. Most of us living in Ikego had no choice in the matter. Actually, you do have a choice. You can shop anywhere. So I know exactly what you're talking about. I used to live in Ikego. And, you know, actually things are a lot better now than they were then, because I used to go there and the joke was, you know, what do you do when something expires? Extend the expiration date, you know. If you liked Hellman's and not Miracle Whip, man, your day was ruined. But it is a convenience store, okay? And so they do buy a lot of stuff. It is a higher price than the commissary. Even things, I'm not advertising one or the other, But you do a lot of your shopping over at the auto port for some of those things, some of like the barbecue type stuff, they also have at the commissary. I would encourage you to comparison shop. Things like if you're one of these turkey fryer people, those big gallon, those big things of oil are like $10 cheaper at the commissary.
Yes, they are.
So, but it is a convenience store, and you are paying for that convenience. So, yeah. Oh, I know the prices are higher, but that's why. Now, long range. So we're talking 10 years from now when Hawkeye Hills opens. It's these other houses in Ikego. What I have asked the director of all NEX is can we get a Next Mart? A Next Mart is a combined commissary slash Navy Exchange. There are only six in the world, and we had one of them. It is written into congressional law. It was the one in Nagishi. And so, I asked Admiral Bianchi to view this as a transplanting from one location to another with just an operational pause in between. Because I think we should have a little commissary capability out in Ikego in the future. And he said, when's this going to happen? I said, probably 5 to 7 years we would have to start at least knowing what label to put on this building. He said, okay, that may be enough time to work it in. So he's going to start working that in with Congress, and it will take that much time. So long term, I mean, I look 15, 30 years down the road on a lot of these planning things. Most folks don't, you know, but it's my job to. So I'm looking at that thing because next, when they sell things that are commissary items, it is a convenience, and that is what you're paying for. But and the answer that you got is commissary is an appropriated fund activity. They get money from our taxes to pay for all their goods. The NEX is not appropriated. It's a business. Okay, they have to make money to pay for their associates, to pay for their equipment. Big difference. Okay, commissary, our taxes are also paying for your food at the commissary. That is why it is cheaper. The NEX is a business. They have to make money. So that is really the... that's really the executive summary.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay, this is for housing. And one recommendation for improvement in – it actually says Ikego, but it applies elsewhere too – this is for the towers – is to post permanent signs on every floor reminding residents to be mindful of their neighbors, especially those that live the floor below them, with regard to noise, specifically children being permitted to run about the apartments or up and down the stairs. The constant running reverberates to the other apartments, and the residents may not be aware of just how much commotion is heard in the other residences. Yeah, so housing, I mean, very true. Housing said, hey, we will make signs, and we will post them in the high-rise buildings. Be considerate. In fact, I was in, I pre-commed the Fitzgerald many, many years ago in Maine. And as you're driving along the 95 in Maine on the highway, they would have these signs that say, you know, dim your lights, your high beams for oncoming drivers, because there's not a lot of traffic out there. And move to the right unless except to pass. And all these basic, you know, things we're supposed to know, but people were more polite, probably because they had this constant reinforcement. Every couple miles they'd have these kind of signs there. So we will do that. But, yeah, you should be aware. And you know what also makes a lot of noise, which I did not realize until I lived on the 8th floor of NECO, and so I've had someone on the 9th floor above me up there. But pets and cats, like a 6 or 7 pound cat, running through an apartment sounds like a troop of horses in the apartment below. It's like, how are these people letting their kids run around 11 o'clock at night? That's what I kept thinking. Turns out they didn't even have kids, or their kids were older. You know, their kids were like, dependents or something like that, off in college or something like that. So they had a cat, and the cat was doing the thing there. So anyway, not that it solves your immediate problem. But yes, be kind, be considerate, and, you do make a lot of noise, you know, because all the buildings are attached. All right, let's see. This is for the bowling alley. Stopped in on Sunday on January 25th, and my wife asked to reserve 2 or 3 lanes for a church group for February 22nd, so almost a month later. And the reservation clerk opened up, bookings open. So the gal said, okay, I'll come back in a couple hours to reserve it. When she came back, they were informed there would be no lanes available because there was the Yokosuka Challenge, had the entire bowling alley. And then, okay. So now this part I'm going to, I don't really agree with this thing. This is totally unprofessional as a manager to not ensure the employees of the bowling alley have operating information and reservations are updated. We had to call 18 kids and inform them we would not be having a bowling party. Well, the good news is you had a month to reschedule that thing. So I mean, that's a bit pile on. I got it. You were irritated. Okay. But that's ridiculous at the end there. So, yeah. So, and the comment is You know, sometimes they get it right. Sometimes they get it wrong. They should have, you know, when they have a special event, should align through the reservation book. That would be the easiest way to go. But a lot of times, think this is a long range thing. So good on you for planning long range. But you know, it'll tell you what's better than having you booked it, show up the day of, and it's not there. Okay. So the manager and everyone kind of, you know, nipped in the bud there. But and you know, they reached out to you and said, feel free to contact Mr. Sam Green directly for your convenience. They'll help you to accommodate you. So. Sometimes you got to give a little bit, so maybe you can move your party a day or two.
Game free pizzas, too.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, so we do try to do right by you on this thing, but it looks like, you know, you came in the 25th of January, the party's the 22nd of February, so you came back the same day. It doesn't sound as disastrous as you made the last line sound, but I got it, you were irritated. So, but yeah, sometimes, you know, the people at the reservation should have been, yes, the right thing probably. Administratively, would have been to write that and zero the book out, but they didn't know it. So, anyway, I'm glad that we caught it in time. I'm glad you got accommodated here. All right, here's the last one we'll do before we take a break here. I called PSD, and this is, I just want to clear this up because I've said this many times. It comes to passports, okay? You came here either on an ID card if you're active duty or a no-fee passport if you are a service member, okay? That is official travel. You're traveling at the behest of the government of the United States. If you want to do any other traveling, you are a tourist. Okay. PSD is us, Navy, official. They don't do tourist passports because that is the State Department who actually handles those things. They used to. They give you a form. They used to drive it up there, but they don't do that. Okay. It's not their job. It's not their job description. Okay. So I preface that here. I called PSD passport office to ask if I needed to visit the U.S. Embassy to renew a tourist passport. Yes, you do. It's very easy to do. You go online, make a reservation, print that out. I've actually been up there myself. A trip to Tokyo, that 3 hours round trip, just the transportation. I was told I need to make an appointment at the embassy. A week later, I heard an ad on AFN that the embassy staff are visiting Yokota to process passports. So I called the PSD passport office again, and I asked the embassy staff to visit Yokosuka. I was told they needed to call the legal services. Yeah, so the embassy does not work with PSD. Sometimes, because it involves citizenship, naturalization, the embassy folks will come down because they come down and swear in a bunch of people. And when they are down here, sometimes they have this open season. They have like 300 appointments, and it goes like that. So we're not going to advertise something that's closed. I mean, we advertise it at YBSM. The commands know. And the ombudsman assembly, they tell them that. And I tell you, that's booked out. So why would – so here's the question still. And just it's new, so it hasn't been answered yet, but I'll answer for you. Why would PSD passport office, as a matter of regular procedure, not mention callers the embassy staff is coming with passports? Because, one, they don't know because it's a legal office. And, two, they don't do tourist passports. Again, PSD, government, no fee. Why doesn't PSD coordinate the legal services to find out? Because it's not their job. It is your job as a tourist to get yourself a passport. And it is so easy to do by going to the embassy. You go online. You get an appointment. You can do it through the mail, too. Yeah, you just like you do it in the States, right? Mail it off and get it back. But you can do it in the embassy. And it's easy. But it's not PSD's job. PSD does passports because you need them for official travel. If you need it for yourself for a personal reason, it is on you. So that's that. I mean, that's why. So don't confuse the two. People get them confused because they both have a blue cover, but totally different. And by the way, you travel on a no-fee passport to some countries, and they won't let you out because you're on a tourist visa. Like, I mean, England and other places will actually check your sofa stand. So got to have a tourist one. Okay, with that, we will take a break for some informational statements, and we'll be back in a moment.
Japan Road Tax season is upon us, and Yokosuka's VRO wants to make the process easier for you. Kanagawa tax reps and VRO staff will be at the Fleet Theater on March 20th, 23rd, and 24th, and April 20th, 21st, and 22nd from 9 a.m. to noon, and again from 1 p.m. to 3:30 to assist you. All vehicle decals must be replaced by June 1st to avoid any issues. So be sure to take advantage of this all-in-one service and stay up to date on your road tax.
Looking for a fast-paced, action-packed day of fun? Come out for a day of paintball at Akego Paintball Paradise. Whether you prefer the mission-based teamwork of Saturday's woods ball games or the fast-paced action of Sunday's speedball games, paintball will get your blood pumping and let you blow off some steam. Don't have your own equipment? Rent a marker and mask for $20, including unlimited air and field fees. E4 and below, play for free. paint is sold separately. Call the Outdoor Rec Center for more information at 243-5732.
Yokosuka's Child Development Home Program is looking for new providers for home-based child care. To get started, stop by the CDH office to begin the application process. Once accepted, they will provide free training and certification. They have a lending library with cribs, baby gates, and more to get you started. And the best part is, this is a real career that you can take with you anywhere, even after UPCS. Call 243-5478 for more info on joining the Child Development Home Team. We're happy to have you. For many kids, high school is learning through classrooms and textbooks. But for some Niles C. Kinnick students, it's a stepping stone for their future. A program called Career Practicum gives them a way to get much-needed job experience in their field of interest.
I really love biology and environmental science, and so I wanted to work with the environmental department to get a feel of what it's really like and see what kind of field work that they get to do and how much, you know, sitting at a desk and paperwork there actually is.
Paperwork is not the first thing people think of when talking about civil engineering, but there are two sides to every job.
It really incorporates so many different skills. Like, you have the people working in the field, and then you have the people working in the office that are planning for the people in the field. So being able to sit down and see everybody working together and how all the different jobs really apply, it's cool to see how many options I have.
Having these hands-on experiences is what could put these kids ahead of other applicants for the same job.
Well, I say it's a good thing. It's good to see, you know, young people taking initiative to do, you know, something that they have a passion for.
The program is part of an initiative to encourage more practical education in science, technology, engineering, and math, preparing kids for a bright future. Petty Officer Sonia Wickard, Yokosuka Naval Base, Japan.
Welcome back, Fleet Activities Yokosuka. Dave Glenister, Marty King, here to talk about your ICE comments. When we went to the break, we talked about passports. And the question was about renewing them and having to go to Tokyo. You know, if you have a passport, you can renew it by mail. It is exceptionally easy to do. In fact, it's even easier. Good for 10 years. So the key is to not let your passport get to the point where you're going to travel on it and you open it up and look at it. So we all have a Japanese mailing address. So in some cases, they say, well, they won't go with a PSC. They will mail to your physical address, which is a Japanese mailing address, and the post office has that. So very easy to do. Take your picture, fill out the forms, you know, much easier. And also, we were talking about the social media side of things. So there's a lot of people in a lot of different circumstances out here. People work on their citizenship, trying to get passports, trying to do whatever, and they may be married to a foreign national spouse or not. And so, again, all you're doing is talking to your neighbor who may have a whole body of experience that you don't have, and then maybe they do know. Maybe it's out of date. Go with the facts. That's just a life lesson, you know? Go with the source. Okay, so here we go. This is about Club T, Club Takamiya. Been a resident of Keigo for many years and always wish for some place to go and have a warm drink and chat with friends. And there was an event out at Club Takamiya on that morning. I guess like a little breakfast thing. My son raved about the biscuit and hot chocolate. Must be a European. Yeah. My wife uses biscuits for cookies, not actual biscuit. But thank you for your support of home business. I hope an early opening becomes a regular occurrence. So, yeah, I actually talked with Kyle Rose about that and having some kind of coffee breakfast thing. And then they transition. So they're going to try that out and hopefully that sticks.
Club T actually has multiple comments saying the same thing for about the past month and a half. Mm. And, you know, they went in and renovated it, and they put in a whole bunch of, you know, new ideas. We haven't expanded the space, but we've been getting a lot of feedback. So not only is that good for the population out in Keigo, but it's also thanks to the staff out there for doing a lot of good stuff for the people.
Yeah. Yeah, so as we have more people going in there, there's more people using Club Takamiya, so there's more opportunity to try things and absorb that cost if your ideas don't work out. But so hopefully they will have this thing. Okay, here we go. This is actually kind of an internal TPU thing, but I just want to mention this real quickly. As a Limdu sailor at TPU, I don't feel it's appropriate for a first-class pay officer and pregnancy orders from the ship to handle personal confidential information for sailors, right? Because she's not screened to fill a staff bill. Well, I am flattered that you think that being screened to a staff billet holds with us this some serious amount of weight in quality assurance. However, staff, ship, this person is obviously qualified to do this, or we wouldn't put them there. You know, personal information, I'm not sure if she's a YN or something, but someone who does this for a living, I am sure. Okay, so what happens is when you go to LIMDU, and LIMDU is only one category, it's limited duty. You may have, for some reason, medical reasons, usually the reason, but there's a whole lot of folks that go through transient personnel unit, folks on pregnancy orders, which actually are permanent, right? And then yes. It's a special category because they can go back to sea again in a shorter period of time. But we get them, and we look through, and we try to, when folks come to transient personnel unit, we try to use their talent. Right. So I always imagine some sailor who, you know, they think that they're going to be behind because they won't be in their rate working on LM2500 gas turbine engines. So how they'll be disadvantaged to the next advancement exam because they're not out of the experience. They already are a little anxious about that. So we do try to match them to their talent and desires and send them out to areas that they're, you know, we send like damage control men, we'll send to the training shop because they do that kind of stuff. As a secondary job.
We're up to our EOC doing our CVRD gear.
Exactly.
We do a lot of the technical surface rates. Mm-hmm. We'll actually TAD to hands here, like ATG
right.
and SLI.
ITs are easy. We have yeah, six, and six shops all over the place.
Six.
Right, so that's what we do. But no, it doesn't matter how you come there. It's a question of talent and skills and what you can do. And so we try to make the most of all of our people there. But this, I don't know what this person may have an axe to grind about something. I don't know. But yes, I don't know. I don't know what. I cannot fathom why you would have an issue, other than this is that sometimes folks at TPU that are there and they are kind of like a workforce that do other things. They've adopted monuments and we do cleanup and we volunteer at parades and open base events. And other folks get screened out to other commands. And so if you're not one of those people, that I can say yes. You might see that you think someone else has a better circumstance than you, and perhaps they do. And all based on if you're qualified to do it, physically qualified and otherwise. So I regret that you may not, don't begrudge somebody else's good deal, but I regret that you view your circumstances as less than you think they should be. So here's one for shout out to the now left Tammy over at the Purdy Fitness Center. She used to do 0500 classes Monday, Wednesday, Friday. And she was great, and so now the class is 0535, and for some folks that have very early start, they're going to be at work at 6, that's a tough one. And so, Roger, your comment, say, can't we get the class to go at 0500 is in the past. So the comment is that, we'd be glad, we are currently in the process of trying to get some new hires, new instructors, but the instructor's a little different. They're kind of like almost like a consultant that we have.
Contract.
So we have a little less flexibility in saying these are the hours. And we can open the gym, but those instructors themselves kind of, we're kind of, not to say stuck, but they have the say of when they can work. So we are at the mercy of the instructor availability when coordinating these, but we do know that is a need, and we are trying to look to fill that. So we'll keep working on that. Here's a comment on the CDC, and there's a someone's not happy with the way the hoof and mouth disease, or hand and foot disease, mouth, hand and foot disease, I guess is what we call it, outbreak. The infection virus has an incubation period of 3 to 6 days, contagion period of several weeks, and so, but here's the thing. Children that have a disease should not be allowed to come to school. Okay, well, as you might imagine, we don't make any of this stuff up, so there are guidelines to handle everything. And that we follow. That way you have standardization across, I don't know, America, but certainly through the Navy CDC system. And so the Development Center upholds the Managing Infectious Diseases in Child Care and Schools guidelines, which is the American Academy of Pediatrics. And so the directions for hand, foot, and mouth disease is not to exclude children from group care unless the child's unable to participate. And staff doesn't have the ability to care for the child without compromising the ability to care for the health and safety of their children. So there is, while I appreciate, the complete containment response would be send them home for several weeks so they can't come back, that we're going to follow the standard guidelines of the of pediatrics, and that's what we're going to do.
American Academy of Pediatrics sets that standard.
Yeah, and so that's what we're going to do. So. Okay. I'd like to express my gratitude to the Housing Service Center for outstanding support during the off-base house hunting journey. Specifically, I'd like to recognize
Ms. Lindsay Fincher and Ms. Sheena McRae. And Ms. Chinone, who's the clerk interpreter, did a magnificent job in working to find us the perfect house, negotiating the rental fee with the agent and ensuring we receive quick feedback on the issues. And Ms. Hashimoto for finalizing the contract. So I kind of bring that up. I want to give a shout out to those people, did a great job. I also want to let you know that that is what happens. And you might say, well, why am I saying this on Commander's Corner? Because, well, everyone already has a house. But the fact is, a lot of folks are moving off. Civilians must move off after 5 years. That's a scenic rule. CNIC, that's the three-star installation folks. And so you have 5 years, and then you do have to move off. So, and there's other reasons. I've actually approved waivers. Some people who say they are married to a Japanese national or a resident. We have some folks who are married to residents that are not Japanese. And they are going to retire, and they want to buy a house. And say, okay, well, if you buy a house, then I am willing to not incur undue hardship and let you move off base and live in it. You know, not, you know, because that's a little different than renting it, right? So there are certain cases where people do that. So once those services are out there, and tell your folks as a sponsor, yeah, we will work with you and help you move off base. Let's see. Although I have no issues with the housing office, the problem they have is with a loud neighbor's motorcycle. Okay, the neighbor owns a motorcycle. They're revving it about 30 minutes, and they went out to the neighbor and asked him to stop, and he said it would only be a few minutes because his battery was dead. Then, you know, to de-escalate, this person left, but obviously they're irritated. So so housing went and did talk with the person. We will mediate for you and do that. I know it kind of puts you in a tough situation, but there is no substitute for actually engaging with your neighbors and, you know, being friendly about it. And I think you'll find that most folks are agreeable. Then you have the folks who say, it's my right to do this thing. You know, housing will help you mediate
yes.
with these neighbors. And it's in your resident handbook of that whole process. So. Here's one. It's a little disappointing one. It says, employees of this one particular agency would like to go to Human Resources to talk about the problems but are afraid to. And, of course, there's no contact information. So what are we going to do with this thing? You know, if you have a problem, you do. You know, if you want to go to Human Resources, you have to actually go. You actually have to say who you are. You can't just make accusations without being able to back it up. Human Resources, if there's a complaint, they will investigate it just like it's a crime.
Yes.
They will interview people, they will take statements, they will do all these things, but you have to participate. And if you don't participate in that process, nothing's going to get resolved.
Won't get fixed.
Yeah.
Yeah, and, you know, if it's a real problem, it's not going to get better over time. Yeah, you have to go to the right resource within your organization and identify the problem. Mm-hmm. And a lot of times, your recommended solutions are needed as well.
Yeah, right, because you might say, you know, the Navy's full of problem finders, and it really don't need any more of those. But if you're a problem solver, you know, people are generally, that helps them. You know, that helps them come up with the answer here. So let's see here. This is someone coming through the gate, okay? And they're coming through the gate. They got this long-term guest pass, which has nothing to do with your vehicle, okay? I'll tell you that right now. I gave her my ID and my parents' passports, informed her we have a pre-approved house guest pass waiting at ISO. And you weren't let in. So unless you signed a one-day pass on the clipboard. I told her we didn't need it because we had a house guest pass and asked that we'd be allowed to park. Okay, when security asks you, say, hey, we'll let you in if you sign this thing, and you say, well, we're not doing that, I'm not surprised they didn't let you in the gate. So no, you can't bring a vehicle on unless the vehicle's allowed to be on. And it may sound like a chicken and the egg, but it's really not. Okay, it's not a chicken and the egg. It is you can't come on unless you're allowed to come on. So you have to park somewhere else, fill out the paperwork, and bring your car on. Now, you can do a lot of this ahead of time if you do your homework and your research. But there's a whole lot of this went into it. Bottom line is, I have not empowered the MAs at the gate to make a judgment call on who they let in and who they don't. They follow the rules. And I tell you, they're very nice about it. And they will say, I regret that you're going to, you know, you have to go park off base or something and walk back and do this thing. But they gave you a shot, and you said, I don't need that thing. So we're not authorized to allow anybody on board without the proper paperwork, all right? FACP, which the Fleet Activities Civil Police, Japanese police, and the security force are following the rules, so an unauthorized personnel are not on board. Now, you were offered a one-day pass, which was going to be used by you to get you and your family your vehicle on board so that you can then go back to ISO, and you refused to sign it. So, no, you can't come in. And so what ends up happening? Okay, you park off base, you fill out the paper, and then you come on. So they gave you a solution. Take it. Believe them. So Your house guest pass allows you to be on the base. The vehicles are totally separate, okay? Totally separate. So, yeah, but then you're given a website, and if you Google Yokosuka ISO, it'll come up, or CIFE ISO, it's Industrial Security Office. All the instructions, all the links, all the forms. Okay. This is an interesting one. Highly recommend that MWR/USO consider implementing a minimum age limit with concerts being held at Purdy Gym. I think it was the Nelly concert. Not that I would bring my three-year-old to Nelly.
Yeah.
And a bowling alley parking lot. I attended three concerts in the past couple of years because you had Daughtry, Five Finger Death Punch, and there were multiple spouses. How do you know they weren't active duty members? Not in the uniform. How do you know they're a spouse? Could have been active duty. I got a lot of active duty moms with little kids. It's kind of fun. We have a very family thing going over here at our picnics. But multiple spouses bring kids as young as 1 year old to the concert. It got so bad that the infants would fall asleep. Boy, that must have been a bad concert.
Yeah.
Oh, you're not talking about the concert being bad? Infants fall asleep at a concert? And the parent would just sit down on the floor during the concert. There were several times that the parent got accidentally kicked and pushed. So I understand your problem. It's a concern with people, you know, sitting down, small kids and everything else. But, you know, we have consciously not set an age limit on some of these things. And we do kind of expect, you know, the basic parenting and safety type thing. I got it. I don't mean to make fun of this one. This is important because I'm not shouting out to you as much as the parents who have the obligation to keep their kids safe,
right,
and who you should reasonably expect you might get stepped on, you know, if you're at a concert and your 3-year-old's there. So, please be careful about that stuff. No, we're not going to set an age limit or age minimum for these things, but. Yeah, because a lot of things, like in the parking lot, it's the parking lot. But, yeah, by all means, take the absolutely bare minimum parental precautions necessary to keep your children safe. I'm stunned I have to say that. There you go.
Yeah.
Okay. Let's see. Zip it on. Let's see. Try to get an appointment for an ID card, but they were not taking walk-ins. Yeah, don't do walk-ins. Walk-ins are like 2 hours long. Get an appointment at PSD to get an ID card and do your research. I guess in this case, they kept calling and calling to see what you need to get an ID card. You need to get an ID card, and we're told they only need their CAC card. You need to have proof of the child.
Two forms of ID.
Two forms of ID.
Also, PSD is not the only place to get an ID card. Yeah. We do have a family assistance office at the Community Resource Center, which is the building directly across from the commissary. Go up to the FAST office. Once again, get an appointment in advance because trying to do walk-ins, competing against appointment times.
Yeah.
And with our new ID CAC cards, which have been around for a while, it is not an easy process.
Because the card is not just a picture. They got to actually load data onto it, biometric data, fingerprints. And I just had my son just turned 10. We made an appointment. We went down there and it still takes a good bit of time, but, you know, he was thrilled. This is his birthday, you know, but picture, fingerprints, and yes, he's now literally a card-carrying member of the CFA community. So it is good stuff, but yeah, make your appointment, make sure you have all the forms of ID that you need, and you'll be good to go. Okay, this one is, I'm not sure if it's a repeat or not, but this is about the youth sports. It was supposed to go to an away game, I guess, and the bus is supposed to leave at 7 because the game was at 9. But when the parents showed up there, none of the coaches are there. And so no one knew what was going on. Just the driver was there. And so there was no email from the coaches or youth sports and telling them there was a time change. Okay, so there's this time change. The whole game shifted a couple hours. So you got a couple bunch of kids up there with just a bus driver. I think some parents went too. That they didn't know the hours had changed. They didn't have really had planned for lunch, per se. And all this is going on, and yeah, I agree. This is unsat, you know, because the bus doesn't come back till 1900, and so everyone's got plans. So, and we talk more about the youth coaches, and keeping that email type stuff going. I also work with youth organizations, and sometimes it's sometimes we do well, sometimes we don't. I think it's important to sometimes you got to pull that stuff. I'm not sure there's another one that's push a rope moments, but. Yeah, so anyway, so what we've done is we've taken, ensured the last-minute situations, all parents contacted via email and by phone to prevent these other issues in the future. We got a policy. We also changed our policy that requires all coaches to ride the bus with their team. So there's accountability and communication, which I think is good. I'm kind of surprised we didn't have that already, to be honest with you, but that's what we have now. And we're looking at meeting with the youth sports staff to make them aware of the well, we're going to tell them about all these comments and tips for pointers. So, and we have a lot of MWR Facebook pages. I think, you know, being, you know, registered on the right page to blast these things out, these notifications. You know, communication is always a tough one there. But I think one of the fundamental things that we've got going here, which is good, is having the coaches on that bus. Because you're responsible for the kids. So, yeah. Yeah, it's unfortunate. So, 5-minute sign. So, congratulations to everybody else out there. Let's see. A couple of shout-outs here to the CDC. And this was that actually, this is just a public service announcement. Yeah, so one of the folks noticed that their child was changing behavior, becoming more quiet, and didn't want to go to the CDC. And so they told the director. And so, of course, Drake jumped on that because you always look, you know, worst-case scenario. What's happening is has there been an incident the child doesn't want to talk about? Are they getting picked on by other kids? Is there did they get hurt and not tell anybody? And now they're afraid to use their certain, you know, toy or something. Who knows? So they watched him for a couple of weeks and observation and did some stuff. And the son's back to his happy self and eager to go to the CDC and has no dread or anything else. So nothing really came out of that. I mean, sometimes you experience that. I actually had a friend of mine who said that his kid would go into almost different personalities for short periods of time, you know, when he was there. And it's trying to find their root personality or something. I don't know if there's anything truth to that. I'm sure someone will chime in with the right answer to that thing. But no, the right thing to do is you call at someone's attention. We want to know about these behavioral changes because that could be an indication of something. And so we want to make sure we track that. And they did. Nothing had happened, of course. But, you know, it gives a shout out here to the CDC staff.
Absolutely. And we got a great staff over there.
Mm-hmm.
A great staff. And
Christine Williams.
Yes.
Yeah. Great job.
They deal with a lot of different issues, a lot of different things.
That's right. I think it was the Kago's Margaret Geary, I think, is a Kago CDC also doing a great job. So, yeah. Okay. There's some things about the fitness center equipment, and you can't make everybody happy, so we only have a certain limited amount of space. This is about some of the cross-training stuff, and so we are changing. There's a comment here about, hey, we should change all this equipment. We started changing it. And there's another comment about how all this equipment you just got rid of was so high used.
There's another comment that I do want to hit on.
Okay.
Yeah. And that is a sailor that was stationed in Yokosuka years ago, 13 years ago. Has been back since multiple times on port visits, and is basically, we get a lot of negative comments about the Purdy Gym and the Fleet Rec Fitness Centers, but this particular sailor here's comment, he actually lives in the States and is commenting that he wishes he was back in Yokosuka because the facilities in the States, including the ones that you have to pay like Bally's, are not comparable to what we have here. And although our Navy fitness team over there can't cater to everyone, they do a great job getting the mass majority taken care of. And yes, sometimes we have to wait in line, and yes, sometimes the piece of equipment that you as an individual must have because you don't like using the universal machine, we understand that, but we have a community of 22,000 people. And
of which I think there's like 15,000 routine authorized users every given day.
Yeah. So we do take your comments for action. John Benningfield over at Navy Fitness acts on all of them. But it's nice to see a positive comment in a comparison from the States.
It is. And do you know you have to pay to join the fitness center at the Pentagon? It's like the only military fitness center I've ever come across you have to pay to join. It's like $20 a month or something like that, to be, which is still cheap, you know, you think about that. But, yeah, you do. So there are other options. Sometimes you got to be flexible, literally and figuratively, in the fitness world, right? I mean, I know not everyone – I mean, working out on ship, that's hard. I mean, I was working out next to a dumpster, you know, and when I first came in, you know, in the Hilo hangar. And, you know, it's not always fun. It's good to have these things when you're in port. But, you know, we are catering to a lot of folks and we're trying to do a lot of things. But it's good to hear, you know, how we look comparatively. Okay, let's see. This might be the last one, but I think, yeah, let's just make it the last one. We can always take the other ones later. On Saturday, I won't give a date, I attempted to bring a visitor to base and was informed that my guest privileges were suspended. After visiting ISO on February 9th, I found the date that caused my suspended privileges was 8 January. This is 27 days from the time I didn't turn in a guest pass. This is unsat. Some sort of notification should have made to me a lot sooner. So you're complaining that we didn't tell you that you lost your privileges earlier. So I'm complaining because you're not following my rules, man. Because the first time, you get a warning letter. If you don't turn in the guest pass, we send you a warning letter signed by me. And the second time, you are suspended, and it's like 30 days, yeah, also signed by me. That's why it takes time for the stuff to come in. So after a little bit of research, found out the reason you were suspended is because you were actually issued a warning letter the first time. Then you violated the policy, which resulted in you being issued an actual violation letter, both of which are attached for your records. We've sent this back. The passes are collected at the red boxes every day, twice a day, and processed, regardless of the amount of time it takes for you to receive the letter notification. So here's the bottom line. You know, we suspend you, and then you can't bring a guest in. I think you're probably mad because you were embarrassed because you tried to bring someone in and you couldn't. But yeah, so it's not, no one gets this the first time around. And as far as the paperwork thing, I don't think most folks know this, and I'm not, you know, trying to say, oh, my life's so rough. But I sign my name at least 30 times before lunch every day. Every time someone has one of these passes, a waiver request, separate in Japan, marry in Japan, all this kind of stuff. A lot of stuff comes through CFA that, you know, via your command, but it all comes to me because I'm kind of like the representative, as before it goes to up towards USFJ, who allows you to do this kind of Japanese interaction. So a lot of those things actually go through our office. So,
yes.
And, you know, the same people are putting everything on letterhead and doing that stuff. So it does. When it says get this 30 days or 2 weeks ahead of time, that's really what they mean. And these things take time to come up there. So.
And for the other folks out there, you know, if your guest left because they had to leave by midnight, mm-hmm, and you didn't put your pass in the red box, you know, don't feel free to go to ISO the next day and turn it in and say, I didn't realize it. And, you know, that's one of those incidents where they'll probably say, thanks for coming in and taking care of
it. Yeah, because it saves us a lot of paperwork of not having to suspend your privileges. That's like, you know, two or three things. Everything gets put in folders and on letterhead and everything else. So, yeah, we want you to kind of do that and say, hey, not hope you got away with it. So, something like that. So, again, I think the takeaways for this week's session, or the several week session, because we go several weeks, is go for the source. Do your homework. Know the requirement. Don't ask your neighbor, sure. It's like Wikipedia, you know? Read Wikipedia, and then go right down to the references and then check those, because it's not an authoritative thing. It's actually much better now. But go with the resources. Go with the actual story and ask, and you will get the actual answer. All right? So.
And come out to the St. Patrick's Day Parade, because it's going to be a blast.
March 8th. March 8th, so that way you can go to Tokyo for theirs the next week.
Yes.
Right? And so with that, we'll say have a great week, and stay safe out there. We'll see you next time.